Hi, my name is Stephanie, and today I want to talk to you about one of the senses, enteroception. So when we think about senses, we tend to think about the five main senses that we get taught about in elementary school: sight, smell, hearing, touch, and taste. With sensory issues being such a focus in the autism world, a lot of times we might be able to identify sensory issues or sensory triggers within those specific five senses. We actually have more than five senses though. However, it appears that not everybody agrees on the categorization and thus the actual number. However, many agree, at the very least, there are more than five main senses. Interoception is one of those senses that you normally aren't taught as a sense, and is important to understand for those with sensory processing disorder or autism and things like that. In fact, interoception has a lot to do with our conversation on alexithymia that we had quite recently in a video. If you want to check that out and you haven't already, please do so. I'll link it up here for you. Interoception is the perception of sensations from inside the body and includes the perception of physical sensations related to internal organ function, such as heartbeat, respiration, satiety, as well as the autonomic nervous system activity related to emotions. A lot of interoception goes on unconsciously. Obviously, we don't tend to really consciously notice our heartbeat or what's going on with different organs or how we're breathing, unless if there's a problem or something seems out of the ordinary. And in that case, it kind of rises to the conscious level and you're like, wow, my heart is beating rather fast, or like, I need to catch my breath. Those sorts of things are interoceptive signals or sensory things that have been going on at an unconscious level that have now been brought into the conscious. These things also include things like, oh, I'm hungry, or I need to go to the bathroom. Those with sensory issues do tend to have a problem understanding what's going on inside their body and thus have an issue with interoception. Maybe the signal for a full bladder is weak or hard to identify, and so accidents happen. Or maybe the full feeling and the empty feeling in your stomach feel the same instead of different, so maybe someone might keep eating or not eat at all. The perceptions of these bodily signals can be kind of hard to perceive or hard to differentiate, etc., in those who have trouble with the interoceptive sensory aspect of things. Problems with the interoceptive sense can affect someone's perception of temperature, hunger, thirst, tiredness, digestion, and heart rate, and more. These signals could be perceived as if maybe they were louder or quieter, or maybe mixed up and upside down, and maybe just they don't make sense. Sometimes they almost like crisscross, and someone might perceive something hot as cold, or feel like they're really, really, really cold on a hot day, or feel like they're really, really hot on a cold day. These kinds of things can happen, or maybe just realize that it doesn't feel hot or cold. Sometimes signals that purposefully make us feel uncomfortable so we act on them, such as being hungry so we eat, can actually feel comfortable to people who have interoceptive sensory issues, so they might not eat because the feeling of being hungry is actually comfortable to them instead of the feeling of being full. So this actually goes along with alexithymia in the realm of emotions and perceiving emotions as physical sensations and vice versa. In fact, this source suggests that rather than being specifically associated with affective impairment, alexithymia is better characterized by a general failure of interoception. And another notes, while it was originally assumed that the interoceptive deficit in alexithymia is specific to emotion, recent evidence suggests that alexithymia may also be associated with difficulties perceiving some non-affective interoceptive signals, such as one's heart rate. It is therefore possible that the impairment experienced by those with alexithymia is common to all aspects of interoception, such as interpreting signals of hunger, arousal, proprioception, tiredness, and temperature. Just like as with other senses, people may seek or avoid certain interoceptive sensory input, and that might lead to behavior that could seem odd or even be very troubling. For the autistic person, issues with interoception can lead to, again, meltdowns and overwhelm because of that difficulty in understanding these signals that are going on inside the body, or the issue of not understanding how to make that signal stop when it becomes overwhelming, and also the kind of effects that it can have on the mind and body because of heeding maybe misinterpreted interoceptive sensory information. Interoception is a very important sense to understand to be able to help autistic children or other children who have issues with this with things that don't seem to be sensory on the surface. Potty accidents and not eating might have their roots in this instead of reasons other people might come up with, such as maybe being defiant or not wanting to comply with the rules or something to that nature. This is a very important reason why understanding an individual's sensory profile, basically what's going on with them specifically when it comes to sensory things and how they interpret certain things, is extremely important in informing best practices in way of support. Some people might think that they need to train that bad behavior out of a child that's actually a sensory issue, for example, like an interoceptive sensory issue, which would be essentially punishing the child for doing what is natural to them and basically punishing them for being autistic. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of knowledge on how best to help those with interoceptive sensory problems. However, some suggest that mindfulness activities might be able to help, as well as a sensory diet. And for those of you who might be confused, when I say sensory diet, I'm not necessarily talking about eating. It's kind of about meeting different sensory needs and being able to regulate through that. I imagine being more accommodating of these sensory issues to try to avoid triggering those things, or to try to help alleviate the issue would probably be helpful. Obviously, avoiding accusations or shaming or punishment for things that are out of the child's control when it comes to sensory experience would obviously be very wise as well. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that you enjoyed it, and I hope that it was a little bit helpful in understanding what interoception is. As always, the links to the things that I read from and get my sources from for research-based videos is in the description if you'd like to check it out, maybe read some more for yourself. If you did enjoy this video, go ahead and give it a thumbs up and let me know your thoughts in the comments below. If you enjoy autism-related content from me, you can go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I upload to this channel every Thursday at 4 p.m. Central Standard Time. Thank you to everyone who supports me here on YouTube as YouTube members, my patrons over on Patreon, and a special thank you to my Spaztier patron, Marie Johansson.
Thank you so much for watching. I hope that you're having a wonderful week, and I'll see you in my next video. Bye!